So I just mentioned that there is a download link for all the material, so the exercises, the solution and the slide deck, but I'll put it back up at the end as well, because the solutions are not in there yet, so you don't need to try to download those yet. We're here for a workshop, which means you'll be doing a lot of work, and I'll just present some things and have a look at all the things that you're doing. So this is me. The only thing really of relevance here is that I work as application security consultant, which means I tend to do a lot of threat models for my customers. And within OWASP, I'm the co-project lead for the threat model project. Normally, we do these workshops under these Chatham House rules, but considering that we're being filmed, I would advise you not to name any of your employers, customers, or things that might be sensitive, because they will be on tape. So you might want to, if you have some questions, you might want to anonymize them a bit. So by show of hands, I would like to get an idea of the group. And the first thing I'd like to know is, does anybody have experience in threat modeling? Yeah, so two people with some experience. Do you have a lot of experience or you just started?
So, just a bit. Tested,
just a bit? Yeah, okay. Then by show of hands as a job role, who is an architect? Developers? Yeah, QA people? No, product owners? No, okay, then you're going to need to help me out. What's your job role?
I'm a consultant.
Yeah, so you're everything. Yeah.
Architects will be architect.
Yeah. Okay.
Pen testers.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. On a pen tester. Hi, come on in. So I'll manage your expectations. We're starting from zero, so that's quite okay since not a lot of people have experience. And I'll teach you how to do a basic threat model, which, for example, if you're a pen tester, will be good enough to use it in an actual pen test. At any time, if you have a question, just yell the question, because I tend to go on with the slides. I might not immediately notice that you have a question. So we're going to get started with an introduction to threat modeling. And when we talk about anything when security related, we need to give it a place in the development lifecycle. So we created this development lifecycle. It's rather generic. Hopefully you're doing some design, you're going to build something, it's going to be tested, and then it goes into production, maintenance mode, however you want to call it. And during each of these stages, you are supposed to do a number of security-related efforts. So threat modeling is to be done normally in the design phase, which doesn't mean that you can't do it on something that already exists. But if you're going to find threats in a design, then it's best to fix it in the design phase before you actually put it out. Now, fixing architecture problems in software is doable, but this could equally be some kind of a hardware product or an IoT product or some hybrid form, and then problems in your architecture will be a lot harder to fix. When you're building stuff, I'm going to, for this workshop that we're doing, going to assume that you're building software. And if you need to build software, then your developers will need some kind of a coding guideline, and there will be some source code review done, either manual or via a tool or both. During the testing phase, there's going to be some dynamic security testing or some pen testing, in other words, being done. And if the thing goes into production, you'll probably need some kind of a hardening guide for your production system. And if it's a web application, you might need to do some web application firewall tuning. So this is quite a generic development lifecycle. It works both in waterfall and agile methodologies. So this is actually color-coded a bit the difference between the three major methods. So in Waterfall, you're going to do a lot of analysis upfront, which means that you'll be doing threat modeling a lot in the beginning, and then things will be built, tested, they go into production. Now, in most of the agile methodologies, things like Scrum, you're going to do just enough design for that sprint, and then the next sprint you're going to add to the design for whatever user story it is that you're creating. Now, in DevOps or DevSecOps, DevOpsSec, however you want to call it, the iterations tend to be even shorter. So you might have actually iterations of just a week. In the end, would you just add all the widths of these little blocks, you would end up in roughly the same amount of design as you would do in Waterfall. So the amount of work is going to be roughly the same thing. Maybe it's going to be done by different people, but you still need to do an amount of work for the design. Now, when we talk about the threat modeling practice, what we're looking at is flaws in the architecture, flaws in the design. What we are not talking about is things that happen in code. Now, if you look a couple of slides back, threat modeling, we do it during the design, so potentially no code has been written yet. So you can't look at problems in the code at that moment in time. But this whole area of things, of secure coding bugs, there we're looking at things like secure coding, static code analysis. There are other solutions to get resilient code, code without too many security problems. There is a lot of different things you can do there that is not threat modeling. So we're going to look at problems in the design, which also means that there is going to be difficulties to automate things since nothing has been built yet. So designs are usually made in programs like Word, Visio. They're on a Confluence page, maybe with a Draw.io. There might be some plant UML diagrams or something, but there's not really something that you can automate. At the moment, there is also no tool out there that could actually create a threat model for you. There is a bunch of threat model tools that can help you, guide you in the threat model process, but you have to look at them sort of like a word processor. A word processor will help you write a document, but it will not write a document for you. So a threat model tool will help you do a threat model, but it can't do the threat, cannot create a threat model for you. There is a number of different definitions of threat modeling. I'm personally liking the second one a lot. Threat modeling could be misunderstood. If you just model your threats, then okay, you have done threat modeling, but you're not bringing a lot of value. What we actually want to do is an analysis of the risks that exist within the architecture. So the end goal of a threat model will potentially be a document or information that you bring to your manager so he can make an informed decision to spend his limited budget on the things that would make your product the most secure. For which we need to do some risk analysis, and of course we're still talking about architecture. So why do we do this threat modeling? Or why should you be doing threat modeling? Well, in the first place, it is good technique, a good tool to spread knowledge about the system that you're building. In the past, when we were still working in pure Waterfall, you had this thing like a technical analyst would write the technical analysis and he would drop it with developers who then started coding, and then he just sent a message to testers like, it's ready to be tested. But there wasn't usually a lot of discussion or conversation going on. With threat modeling, this is one of the things that we will certainly do. That's why all the exercises will be in group. You will have lots of conversations, and all the stakeholders involved will be up to speed with the threat model. So everybody knows what the problems are, and there is some kind of a consensus within that group. This is what needs to be done. Of course, we split it up a bit. So there will be an increased risk awareness. We will be able to prioritize things. Of course, we need to have some documentation, at least for things like GDPR and other compliance rules that we need to follow. If they say that you have to have documentation, we will have to write it somehow. So these are all reasons why we actually do threat modeling. And threat modeling is a relatively simple process. So most of the time, when people come and follow a threat model course or they come do these types of workshops, they think that threat modeling is something that's difficult, that you need a lot of expertise to do it. But that's not actually the case, because it's just answering four questions. What is it that you're building? What can go wrong with that thing? What are you going to do about it? And at the end, did you do a good enough job? The last step, the quality assurance step, is quite important, because this is going to be the trigger to start again at the beginning and expand on the diagrams you created. Again, look at identifying all the threats and the mitigations and things like that. So as long as you document this or follow these steps, you're doing threat modeling. You might not be following one of the well-known methodologies, but that in the end doesn't really matter. As long as you're doing this and at the end you mitigate some threats, then you made your system or your application more secure. Now, when we talk about this diagramming step, the question, what are we building? When you do a pen test or when you need to talk about something, the first thing you need to define is the scope. What are we actually going to do? A diagram is a great tool of doing so, because it does not contain a huge amount of text, which means that people from different language backgrounds can easily understand the thing that we're actually building and what needs to be either developed or tested and things like that. So in our diagrams, what do we want to achieve? Well, we certainly want to have the most important use cases in there, in the diagram, because those will be the things that will make money for your organization, or they will be the reasons why you're building the system. And these are the things that definitely need to be looked at, because they have to be up to a certain level of security. Now, what that level is something that somebody else will decide probably for us, but we still need to know all these things. You need to be able to answer questions like, why are we building this? Is this purely for compliance? Is this going to make us money? Is this the only application that is making us money? Or is this just one of 500 products that we put out there? We need to know how this system sits within the architecture of the organization, and we need to know what the system is going to do. Of course, we'll also look at security requirements in here. If you're building a tool for internal use and in your model it's already clear that you're opening it up to the internet, you can already have these discussions. So how do we do these diagrams? How do we draw these? Well, we prefer to start with data flow diagrams, because they are quite easy to read. A lot of us have also studied data flow diagrams or the complete set of UML diagrams back in school. We might not use it anymore, but data flows are quite easy to read. And additionally, data flows are very good at looking at interactions, because that's what a data flow is. You show the flow of data, so all the interactions are probably going to be in there somewhere. Now, of course, we're going to, during the exercise, start off creating the first diagram. Later on, you will probably need to expand it as new functionality comes in. Very important when you create these diagrams is that you give things a name and a number, so that you can later, when you talk about something, that you're sure that you talk about the same thing. You're also supposed to enumerate your assumptions or dependencies, if there are any. Now, this is one of the things that is often forgotten. So think about this when you do the exercise. Everybody is going to make assumptions. Sometimes they are subconscious, and then it's difficult, of course, to write them down. So you'll sometimes need to take a step back and see which kind of assumptions that you're making. How do you create a data flow diagram? Well, basically, there is just four elements and trust boundaries on there. I usually start with a process. A process is a part of your system. It's the thing that is going to handle the data that goes through your system. External entities are all these things that are outside of the development of this system, but that have interactions with you. Now, these can be really external to your organization, but they could also be internal systems that you're not currently developing as part of this data flow. They're still called external entities. You have some arrows to show the flow of data. The labels of these arrows will be quite important because that will define how good it or how easy it is to read this data flow. And at some point, you will need to persist your data. You need to store it somehow, because why else would data be flowing in your application if you're not going to store it anywhere? And when you created your first diagram, you need to add some trust boundaries. And the trust boundary has a rather vague definition. It just says whenever there is a change in the level of trust. Now, this is difficult in the beginning. When we do the analysis of the question, what can go wrong, we'll be basing ourselves on the trust boundaries. So in the beginning, it might be good to draw a couple extra. If you're not sure that it's a trust boundary, then we're just going to put one. And then we'll have a little bit more work in the analysis. And as time goes by and get better at threat modeling, you will get an instinctive feeling or whether or not you need to put a trust boundary there or not. Trust boundaries always go over a data flow. So in an example, this is the Get Me an Offer web application. It's an application for an insurance company that want to make sure that when potential customers come to their website, by inputting some data, they can get back an offer for an insurance. Now, how does that work? Well, the client is going to the web application. They input some data. It's sent to the backend that is getting out of the database either some additional data or some parameters of the calculation that needs to be made. It sends all that stuff back. The web application is going to create something like a nice PDF file and send it back to the client. So that is one use case within this data flow diagram. The same way, there are agents. Agents actually need to update or access client information because they want to manage the clients. Of course, when they access client information, the web app needs to go to the backend that fetches some stuff out of the database to actually display it to the frontend. Now, these trust boundaries that I talked about, these are your attack surfaces. These are the places where you will actually want to do some testing, because that's where the attackers will be focusing their effort. There are a number of examples here, but the easiest one to start with is the network. So if you look at a network level, then agents and clients probably come from the internet. The web application will probably be in a DMZ, and hopefully the SAP system is somewhere in a separate backend, and the database might be even, again, in a separate VLAN, or not. That remains to be seen. But from the network segmentation, you can already see that there are different levels of trust. If somebody put a firewall in between, then he probably had a good reason to do so. So when we draw these trust boundaries, we end up with something like this. So it's trust boundary one, and it intersects these two data flows, which means that since it's one trust boundary, we actually trust the agents and the clients about the same, because else I would have drawn two trust boundaries. But basically, both of them come from the internet anyway. Between the web application and the SAP system, there is also a trust boundary, and between the SAP system and the database as well. So when you draw your first diagram, keep this in mind. The network structure is probably the easiest way for you to first start thinking about your trust boundaries. Which brings us to the first exercise. So everybody should have some papers on his desk. The first page is going to be the description of the system, and the next pages are the exercises. You already received exercises 1 and 2 and 4. Exercise 3 is missing because it contains a solution to exercise 2, so you'll get that later on. And we are going to create a diagram of these web and mobile applications with the same backend. And HHB is actually the Acme Hotel booking system. What does this system do? Well, they already have a system at the moment and they want to migrate stuff to the cloud. So what are they going to do? Well, first, what are you going to do? You need to create a context diagram. You need to make sure that you have a data flow diagram. Well, let's just drop the context diagram. We'll just do the data flow diagram and save ourselves some time. Identify the five most important trust boundaries. List some of your assumptions and ensure that when I have questions or somebody has questions, one of you will be the representative to actually answer them. So you'll need two roles, a reporter role who can answer my questions when we look at the different models, and a moderator role whose role it will be to keep track of time. Because we're going to need to time box this. So this moderator will need to keep track of time. And I'll give you 15 minutes to do this. The groups will be rather easy. So every row is one group. That's going to be the easiest. So it's 4, 5, and 3. How many people in a group doesn't really matter. So have a quick read through the exercise. Put yourselves together and start on the diagrams. If you have any questions, I'll be walking around. And at 2:40, we'll have a look at potential solutions that you made and the drawing that we made, and we can discuss some differences. Within each group, who was the reporter? And no cheating, because I just heard you guys ask who the reporter was going to be, so you didn't assign him up front. And who was the moderator?
I was the moderator.
Yeah. Did you guys have a moderator and a reporter? No. So the reason why we actually put this in is just to show you that that's actually also things that happen in practice. Roles and responsibilities within a threat model need to be defined, because else you'll all be looking at each other, and just like many of you haven't met each other before, it will be in reality as well. We'll look at it a little bit later. But the stakeholders in a threat model, it's people from the business, people from security, architects and developers, groups that usually don't talk to each other all that much, strangely. How many of you listed some assumptions? I know they listed some assumptions. You have some assumptions? Okay. Let's hear an assumption.
So we assumed that mobile traffic would be encrypted over SSL TLS.
Yeah, that is an assumption. That's certainly an assumption you might want to note down at that moment in time. We'll come back to that discussion later on when we look at the actual, when we try to identify the threats. Because then that question is certainly going to pop up. You guys had an assumption as well?
Yeah, so when we were looking at the trust boundaries, we decided that the firewall and the load balancer would be within the same trust area.
Yeah. So I know this group made another assumption. They were assuming that the mobile application is actually just a web application. So it's just a fancy web application, but then put on a mobile app. That's also a good assumption in itself, because it will mean that they can actually use the same API in the backend, which might make things a lot easier for your developers. So we'll have a quick look at a possible solution as we created it. So I'll immediately scroll to the thing with the trust boundaries. Oops. Okay. I'll have to put it on the screen, of course.
Yeah.
So this one is slightly bigger than what you have drawn, of course. We didn't just put this one in 10 minutes either, so there is slightly more work on this one. There is a number of things that I would hope that you either have written down or after I explain it, that it makes sense to actually put it down. First of all, you have customers, probably the most important use case, but everybody had a customer. We modeled the mobile application and the web application separately because a mobile application is going to run on somebody's mobile phone and that web application is going to run on my web server. So it's certainly two places, so it makes sense to actually model it as two different things. Now, from the text, you could deduce that hotel owners and account managers also use the web application, but the travel agency, for some reason, had direct API access. It's the same API as for the mobile application in the diagram that we created. Of course, if you're building it, it might be two different APIs. It's just the question of what are you building. So depending on what you draw, it will actually have meaning and it should reflect what you're actually trying to build. So if all the three groups were trying to build the same thing, you should end up with roughly the same data flow model. But considering that this group said in the beginning, okay, but this mobile app is just like a browser, so we're just not drawing that because we're not so much interested in that, that could be an acceptable decision. Now, where are some things where I saw most of the groups, let's say, not be very good at? That is naming all the arrows. So if you have arrows without names, yeah, I know data is flowing, but I have no idea what is going on. So when you do a data flow of a use case, then usually it is also a lot easier because you know a customer wants to book something or manage his booking, then it's easier to put the names on than when you just get a text. So, okay, the exercise doesn't really help you remember that you have to put names on things. And of course, the trust boundaries, we number them. Naming them is difficult because if you name them something like customer to web application and at some point something changes from name, you have to start renaming all your trust boundaries. That's just asking for problems. Now, we put up a lot more external entities than most of you put in. But that is because we had slightly more time. And of course, if there is a customer who does some kind of a booking, you're going to need some kind of a payment system. And if you have payments, you're going to need some kind of an accounting system. There was some administration that needed to be done and things like that. There are some interactions that were not specifically mentioned in the text, but that will always be there. In this case, we said, okay, developers are actually creating this API and they're actually uploading it. It might be a CI/CD system, so the moment they change something, it actually gets uploaded. Now, once you know that, if you have to do some like a red team exercise or a pen test, then suddenly the developers come into scope, because if you can actually get on one of their laptops or get their credentials, then you'll just upload an API with a backdoor and you can get all the data without having that getting past that pesky web application with the web application firewall and all that stuff. So if you were to go with your group through a couple of iterations, you would end up with something like this. Because at some point, somebody like me representing the business is going to look at it and is going to say, okay, but what about these travel agencies? And where are the administrators? And how do we actually get hotel data in there? Oh, we need these account managers in there. So even if you didn't have this complete diagram with a couple of iterations, you would end up with something fairly similar. What I would be careful about is when you look at this, you see all the processes have functional reasons for being there. So a web application is there because we need that functionality. There is a whole range of things that is actually also there that we're not drawing on this first level of a diagram. Things like firewalls, web application firewalls, load balancers, and all that stuff. When we look at potential problems, of course, it will come back into play. Because a thing like a load balancer might help you against denial of service attacks. So how deep do you want to go with this? Well, this is a data flow level one. If you need to go deeper in order to explain things, then you will need to go to a level two, a level three, and things like that. But for that, we don't really have the time during the workshop. So now you created your first data flow diagram. I think it went okay. I mean, you might not end up with the example solution that we had, but within your group, if that diagram is good enough to explain to everybody what is happening, then the diagram is good enough. Once you have your diagrams, you of course need to go to the next step. What are all the things that can go wrong? Which is usually the focal point, of course, of an actual threat model. So we need the model in order to start identifying all the potential threats. Now, today I'm only going to talk about one technique. It's called STRIDE, invented within Microsoft quite a while ago, if I'm not mistaken, somewhere in the 80s. And they decided that when you need to make a list of all the potential threats, it helps you, if there is some kind of a mnemonic, to help you think about potential threats. So here are six questions, categories, however you want to call them, to help you think about threats. Now, the first question that people usually have, what if there is a threat that doesn't fit into any of these? Well, if you thought about it, very well, you just put it down somewhere. You don't even need to put it down with any of these. You found a threat or you thought about a threat. Now somebody needs to go and fix it or at least think about fixing it. The six categories are as follows. The first one talks about spoofing. Spoofing is any place where you can actually fake some kind of identification. Tampering is changing data. Or changing the code of an application. Wherever you make changes in order to achieve a certain impact, we call it tampering. Repudiation is actually anything that has to do with audit trails. Audit trails are quite important these days, so there is a separate category for it. Information disclosure is potentially the biggest one. It is each time somebody gets to see data that he shouldn't be seeing. So each time here we say attacker, of course, information disclosure can also happen by accident. You send out an email to somebody that wasn't meant for him. If there is personal data in there, you have a GDPR problem. So information disclosure is quite a broad category. Denial of service handles anything that has to do with availability. Depending on the system you're building, this can be quite important or not important at all. For example, an online booking system should have good availability. There is a lot of competition there. If your website is down, they'll just go to somebody else's. A website from the government might not have high availability needs, because if it goes down, it's not like you can request your visum from anywhere else anyway. So if it gets down or taken offline for 5 minutes, not really a disaster, they need to come back. Elevation of privilege, when we talked about the first one, identification, this one talks about authorization. We always think about elevation of privilege in two directions. So if you're a customer, can you do things that an administrator could do? That's called the vertical privilege escalation. But if you're a customer, you should also not be able to look at bookings from other customers, your horizontal privilege escalation. So both of them should be handled in this category. Now, these are potential threats. There is, of course, something that we would like to achieve. So you want authentication, integrity, non-repudiation, confidentiality, availability, and authorization. So no matter how you look at it, either you think about it this way or this way, it doesn't really matter as long as you come up with a bunch of potential threats that you can then later ensure that they are mitigated. Now, when you do this try thing and you start asking yourself these questions, we need to realize we don't need to do this for everything. So for a process, we want to investigate everything because processes are the things we're actually building within this system. That's why we made it a process. If you made something an external entity, it means it's going to interact with you. Well, if it interacts with you, then you probably want to know who it is. And you probably want to know if he's actually also keeping some kind of a log file, something like that. For a data flow is a rather special thing. Data flows between two points or it doesn't flow. It's a binary thing. It doesn't actually have a lot of properties. So you cannot spoof a data flow. You could spoof either side of the data flow, but not the data itself. It's physically there or it isn't. You could tamper with the data flow or you could read the data flow. And potentially, you could denial of service the connection itself. But a data flow doesn't have any kind of audit trail because it's data that flows. It's not persisted at that moment in time. And if you can't have an identity, then you can't have privilege escalation because in order to authorize, you must first authenticate. With a data store, it's roughly the same thing. So you want to make sure nobody is tampering your data at rest or no unauthorized people can read it. You need to make sure it's available because else the thing is not doing anything. And you need to ensure that your audit trail on your data store is okay if you keep your audit trail in the database because else you could change an audit trail and then the whole audit trail would have no meaning. Now, why do we show this? Well, we need to think about this stride, these six things that we can put the threats in. We have this data flow diagram. So clearly, there is going to be an element, a data flow, and another element. It could be two processes, a process and an external entity, a process and a data store. And we put our trust boundaries on a data flow. So we need to analyze three things. The easiest way to do it is to create a table with the three elements. And then for each element, say, these are the things that we envision already. These are the things that we are going to build. And there might still be some vulnerabilities left. We are going to, of course, use try to help us think about these things. And it's not so easy to see, but there is a number of cells that have been grayed out. That's because, for example, for an external entity, we're not interested in tampering. They're the ones inputting the data. They need to be able to enter the data. So this is grayed out because it doesn't make any sense to actually have a look at it during this analysis. It's not always that clear cut. There are some corner cases where you do have a potential threat that you say it's probably in tampering, but we don't need to investigate it. If you think it's a threat, just put it on there, and then we'll figure out later if it's something for us to fix or for somebody else. But you find a potential issue. And the one thing that you cannot do is once you know about an issue, you can't ignore it anymore. We'll see that when we go on the, when we talk about the risk analysis. Ignoring threats is simply no longer possible once you documented them. So this example, how does it work? Well, the clients and the agents in the Get Me an Offer application, they're going to connect to our website and they're going to use a username and a password to authenticate. Now, for clients, that's probably good enough. But here we say, okay, but for agents, we actually want two-factor authentication. It's not the best description because we are not so much describing a vulnerability as we are describing a missing mitigation. But still, it's clear that we want something here and we can always improve on it later. Now, we don't know if clients or agents actually have an audit trail, but even if they have an audit trail, we don't have access to it. So from this side, there is no audit trail, which potentially might be a problem. Maybe when we do the risk analysis, we will see that there is no actual impact. And if there is no impact, then there is no risk, and then it's solved by itself. If you look at this data flow, here we're saying, okay, we're going to use TLS, which is almost standard these days for web applications. So that means that I won't be able to tamper or read the data while it's in transit. Well, I could tamper it, but what comes out on the other side then is a bunch of rubbish and nothing will happen. When we look at the availability, there was no fallback service provider. So if we lose connectivity for some reason, let's say there is some plant maintenance on the line going on, then people simply can't book anymore. The get me an offer process is in the beginning a little bit more difficult to analyze, because here for a client it's quite easy. How are we sure this is the client that we're looking for? The same way we need to think now, this get me an offer web page, how does a client actually know he's on the correct page? Well, the browser is checking the TLS certificate. If somebody, for some reason, hijacks the URL or registers a URL in our name, then probably they will have a different TLS certificate. Well, at least not one that is assigned or ordered by your organization. If he's doing some fancy man-in-the-middle attacks, then the TLS certificate will certainly not be correct, and hopefully your browser will either tell you or simply refuse to go to the website. Apparently, they're not doing input validation on the data that they're getting. Now, this is the gray area where you can say that's something that should actually be done in secure coding. But when we talk about business rules and things like that, okay, often we have processes involved. And when you have processes involved, like an onboarding process, these are things we also look at during a threat model. Apparently, the server is not logging user actions for some reason. And when it talks to the API, it does it in clear text. The API itself is not in here. This is a disadvantage of putting your trust boundaries on your data flow. This column will be repeated in several locations because, as we saw in the diagram, lots of things talk to this web application. The same thing here, there is a load balancer. So load balancers are mentioned, but we don't draw them on the diagram. And they're doing access control. I assume they're doing role-based access control, so there shouldn't be any privilege escalation. Now, these stride tables are quite interesting if you start thinking about these things a little bit further, because what you see here in this left column, it's a bunch of requirements. Now, all this stuff still needs to be implemented somehow. So if you do a pen test, then you can often find things in here to already put in your report. So you already know beforehand they're going to be using TLS. So what do you do in a pen test? Where you're going to check the TLS settings. Are they still allowing too short ciphers, too short key lengths, or older algorithms they should not be allowing anymore, and things like that. So a threat model, and then specifically the try tables, are quite useful as input for testers, either pen testers or functional testers, because there is a lot of requirements here. And once you know the vulnerabilities, you also know where you can focus your testing, because in the next step we'll be finding some solutions for the problems. And then these are also things that need to be tested. So we'll go to the next exercise. We're going to find the threats for the thing that you just looked at, but instead of starting from your own diagrams, I will hand out some copies of the diagrams that I showed so that everybody starts from the same thing again. So I want you to perform a stride analysis of the customer using the mobile app towards the API. In the description, there's going to be some security controls, so these will be okay. You need to find potential problems and, of course, note down which things will be okay. Again, list assumptions if you have one. And you need to assign a new moderator and a new reporter. For this, I'm going to give you just 10 minutes, because else we won't be able to finish in time. So I'll hand out the stack of papers first. If you pick one and just hand it through. Keep the same groups, just assign somebody else as a moderator and somebody else as a reporter. And again, I'll be walking along if you have any questions. For ease of use, I'll make a projection of the table again, so you don't need to reinvent the whole thing. And let's say by 4:15, we'll have a look at the solution. So, now that you had some time to actually try this out, I think most of you didn't get past the mobile app going to the API, so I'm showing that one. In the solution, you'll find the customer actually using the mobile app. Now, it's normal that you didn't finish this, because we simply don't have the time in a 90-minute workshop to go through it. But what you did have is a lot of conversations on how these things should be going. So just for that reason, this exercise is already quite interesting. Just imagine that everybody of the stakeholders is there, such as the lead developer or somebody like that. And all these discussions take place and they need to develop stuff. He already knows exactly when it comes to security, how these things are supposed to work. If then it appears that he can't implement this for one reason or another, he already knows who to talk to have this discussion again. So conversation and communication are a key part of this threat modeling process. Now, we put in some stuff on the screen. I'll quickly go through it. If it's a new type of table or a system that you're not familiar with, how do you start? Well, personally, I always start with the data flow, because it's either going to be encrypted or not encrypted. If it's encrypted, then you've got something to fill in here. And if it's not encrypted, there is a high chance that that is actually a vulnerability, because literally every data flow should be encrypted. That's something we learned from the Snowden papers. So that's usually an easy one. Also, availability on the data flow is usually data that is quite readily available. And then I start with the authentication part, because that is usually also relatively easy. In this case, it's a technical account with a username and a password. And on the API side, since they're using TLS, the mobile app is sure, because he knows there is a server certificate. Now, the mobile apps can be reverse engineered, so this username and password is going to get out. It's going to get out rather fast, because mobile apps are literally trivial to reverse engineer. I mean, there is tools that do it almost automatically, or completely automatically, if in case of an Android application that's written in Java, then it can go quite easy. So these are a number of things that you could have thought about. Now, the description of this workshop said that it was a fast-paced workshop, and we only have 10 more minutes to do actually the rest of the workshop. So I'm gonna shift into two gears higher, because else we simply won't be able to make it, and we still want to at least address some threats. We already discussed this, so this is your stride, this is the things you actually want. Now, when you need to think about the things that you actually want, you need to think about these things within a threat model on different levels. On an organizational level, you need to think about procedures like onboarding, horizontal movement within the organization, how do we handle people leaving, and things like that. In architecture, we need to look at things like, are there standard solutions within our organization? Do we do single sign-on with Active Directory? Because if that is the case, it makes little sense that you are going to develop something completely new. You need to look at the application design. Remember in the beginning, the very first model that we created, you had these travel agents with direct API access. Now, the API has direct access to the database, which means the three-tier model is completely broken. And if you want defense in depth, then you want at least a three-tier model. So there should have been something in front, and that API, which contains all the business logic, should be somewhere in the backend. The same with the mobile app. It should not be connecting directly to that API. There should be another API in front. We need to look at the technical implementation. Is it feasible? Do we actually know how to do it? Because if we don't, we're still in design phase. There is still time to actually get in an expert and do it correctly. And we'll need to have a look at the operational side of things, because if we are looking at certain mitigations, we can take a hit in extra licensing, extra maintenance cost, potentially being less user-friendly when, for example, you want to add a CAPTCHA to stop brute force attacks. Well, you're going to need some kind of a help desk of people calling because they can't solve a CAPTCHA. There are a number of design principles you can keep in mind if you need to fix all the problems that we just found. Minimizing the attack surface is always a good thing. Basically, things that should not be open to the internet, or if people have a way to VPN into the network and then use applications from there, that's an easy way to block off the complete internet access to an application, which means you minimize or reduce your attack surface by 99%. That's always a good thing. You'll want to have secure defaults. You'll want to take into account the privilege of least principle, the least privilege principle. You want to have defense in depth, fail securely. There are enough examples. For example, Apple had a problem at some point with the iOS that was not failing securely, who was not handling TLS correctly. Don't trust, well, it's trust but verify should be the actual name of the principle. You want separation or segregation of duties. So when you have people that are both customer and administrator, when they go for administrative task, you probably need them to authenticate again. You don't need to ask for their username and password again, but probably they will need to do something else at that point in time, like a second factor or something like that. You want to make sure that your security is good, and obscurity, you can still add it later. Like if you have JavaScripts, you do want them minimized and obfuscated, of course, but that's not going to be your primary line of defense. That's just making sure that you annoy the hell out of pen testers, because now they have to figure out which version of that JavaScript you're actually using. You want to keep things simple, because the more simple your architecture is, the more simple your security is, the easier it is to change things in there. And you need to fix security issues correctly. Basically, you need to make sure that you know the root cause and that you can patch the problem at the root cause. Now, how do you fix problems? Well, first you want to redesign. If a problem is designed away, then physically it's impossible to do it anymore. Now, you could apply standard mitigations like TLS, but as I already said, TLS might have an implementation problem at some point, and even though you have a perfect mitigation, suddenly you do have a new risk involved. You don't want to invent new mitigations, we'll come back to that, and it is possible for business to accept vulnerabilities in the design. Now, important here is the one who accepts the vulnerability is also the one who's responsible for it. So the people in the threat model group, the people creating the threat model, will not be able to accept vulnerabilities because we don't want to be responsible for these things. This is usually done by management and most often by people from the business side, because they can either accept the vulnerability or want you to fix it. And if they want you to fix it, they'll need to come up with a budget for you to do so. Now, inventing mitigations is hard, so you don't want to do it. Now, Bruce Schneier was talking here about cryptography, but we've seen it on all kinds of other things as well. You might think that you invented the latest and greatest thing. If that's the case, create a startup and sell it as a product. And after 5 years, if you're not yet bankrupt, then we can talk again about this. Otherwise, you probably don't want to do this for the organization you're actually working for. The same goes about risk. So Professor Stafford here shows that he has a very low risk appetite. Now, the risk appetite of your organization is something that you need to be aware of. Financial institutions, insurance institutions tend to have a lower risk appetite than some other companies. Some other companies are perfectly willing to trade off security to be first to market, because unless you're first to market, you'll be bankrupt, and then all the security is not helping you anyway. So these are things to take in mind when we need to set the priorities. And when we look at the priorities, we look at the OWASP risk rating methodology, but then a simplified version, in which there is this principle: if you know the business risk, then you use that, else fall back to the technical risk. Risk is always the same calculation. You have an impact, the business impact, or the technical impact, and you have a likelihood. You give both of them a number, you multiply them, that's the number for your risk. It doesn't really matter which one of these methodologies you use, as long as you all use the same one, and as long as they are not too subjective. Now, this is a simplified one. Why is it simplified? Well, first of all, I can easily explain the risk calculation to a manager, and in the end, he needs to decide. So if you have something like CVSS, yeah, try explaining that to a manager. That's not going to happen. So this is easy. You only have three levels, and the first three things constitute a likelihood, and the last one is the impact. You multiply them, and that's actually your risk score. Depending on how high the risk score is, you give it a high, a medium, and a low. These are the things you present to a manager, preferably not this calculation, because you don't want to get bogged down when you are there to explain the risks on things like, yeah, but I think this should be a one. Well, it's good that you think that, but we as a group put it on a two. So that's why you want to present this part and not the whole calculation in your final report in the management summary. Now, when you do mitigations, we modeled the system, we identified the threats, we analyzed some risk and gave it a score. We have a risk strategy. Well, it's probably determined upfront. So we're going to select some mitigations. We need to document them, because somebody will need to actually go and implement them, and a tester will need to go and verify them. So that's the validation stage. And then you'll probably want to start from the beginning again. So you want to iterate over this threat model process. We're not going to do this exercise because we have 5 more minutes. And I do want to tell you some stuff on how to do this in the most efficient way. First of all, meetings are needed because you need to discuss stuff. So if you're with a group of people at a flip chart drawing a data flow diagram, that's okay. You're discussing in the meantime. But things like a stride table, all the tables you need to create up front. It makes no sense that 6 people are looking at you creating some tables in Word or Excel. So when you did your first meeting and you have your data flow diagram, when you come in a second meeting to do this stride analysis, start with the data flow walkthrough, because it will be a couple of days or weeks later. People will have thought about it and they will immediately start improving already on this data flow. You need to identify the most interesting things. And what is interesting? Well, assets. An asset is something your company wants to protect, usually something like data. And which are the entry points or the trust boundaries for which you created the model in the first place? So you might want to find a way to prioritize them. You might want to say, okay, we're doing a standard threat model on a web application. So anything that's internet facing, that's what we look at first. And our internal administrators, okay, there could be an insider threat, but hopefully you have less insider threat problems than you have people on the internet trying to attack your application. So again, you'll need to walk through the stride in the next meeting to ensure you didn't forget something. Surely in the beginning, these meetings will be a lot of small iterations and adding stuff to your stride analysis. But even if you go through it once and you fix just one problem, your system, your application is still more secure than if you wouldn't have done your threat model. As you noticed, you need to time box things because else this is going to be an 8-hour meeting instead of a 2-hour meeting. You need prioritizations because that you need in the time boxing. And you need to ensure that you align things on applications risks and thus also business risks. It is almost impossible to get a budget if you can't show that there is a business impact. If you're not impacting the business, then why would you even fix it? So, as I said in the beginning, you need to do a lot of communication. If you want to get the most out of your threat models, you'll want to spread that knowledge also to other teams, like the security testing team, the normal testing team. You'll want to have something of threat modeling for your suppliers, something like a minimum security baseline, some non-functional requirements, security requirements out of your data flows. For example, all data flows must be encrypted. It's something you might want to insist for with your suppliers. If they are software suppliers, basically they're your external developers, then they just must follow the threat model and the mitigations that you put forward in there. So you now know how to create your first threat model. You need to update it. When you update it, well, if you're doing agile, that's easy in every sprint. If you're not doing things agile, whenever you do something major in terms of either a technology update or new functionality, because that will mean new data flows, new use cases, and new processes to look at. You'll need it reviewed and ready before implementation, because that's actually input for the developers. And you need to iterate. So the easiest way to do a threat model is start small and then expand. And because you're expanding every time, you get better at it. The thing that you already created is going to be of higher quality each time as well. You've got basically three strategies for things that already exist. You can either create a threat model of the complete thing that you have now. That's going to take some time. You could say, nothing happened so far. So everything that's in there seems to be reasonably secure because we haven't been breached yet. So you do a threat model of all the changes. Or you could say, we're just going to start with the most important use case. And then next month, we're going to add the use case and iterate and increment that way. Those are the three most logical ways to go about and do threat modeling on stuff that already exists. We have done a lot of consulting with companies where threat modeling was attempted but also failed. So what did we learn from that? They want to start with a complex system. That's usually not a good idea. Meaning a threat model of your secure development lifecycle is not the threat model you want to start with. Start with something you know, like a normal web application. If you don't get the right people in the workshop, first of all, you won't have the good information. And second of all, when you come at the end and you present something to a manager, you can't present a good consensus. If the security team is not in there, they're still going to have a huge amount of remarks on whatever it is you're building. You want to keep your session short. You want to keep them close to each other. There might be a couple of days in between, but if you wait 2 months between your model and your stride analysis, then most of the information will be gone. If you want to start in a project, you can only start when there is actually something to be designed. So if you're too early and nobody is entirely sure how they're going to build stuff, well, then there's nothing much to threat model to start with. And you'll need a lot of manual work to actually do your threat modeling. There is also things that our customers told us after we gave them a course in threat modeling. Like, we were pleasantly surprised to figure this out. a better understanding of the project, because all the stakeholders are in there. You can, if you work feature-based, then these sessions like we do now can be actually quite short. And you could do a threat model on a feature in under 30 minutes. And if you have two or three features in a sprint, it's doable. If you have 10, it's still reasonably doable to do it for all your user stories that go into a sprint. It can be applied to almost anything. So not only software, but it also works on hardware. It works on combined system. We are doing it a lot now for critical infrastructure, where it works just as well as for a web application. It's a great way to scope and then give it to your testers. And if you document it well, you can use it for your GDPR documentation and your compliancy needs that you might have. We're not going to do the CI/CD pipeline threat modeling. I'll just talk you quickly through the resources. You've got whiteboards. You've got Draw.io. That's free. So you don't have to use Visio. Mind mapping tools can become a useful tool if you have to do attack trees. There is the Microsoft threat modeling tool. Like most tools, it is a bit of a tie-in. It's not easy to export from it and go to another tool, but that's true for every tool. The OWASP Threat Tracking project is currently not very well maintained at the moment. You have ThreatSpec if you want to go in the behavior-driven approach of things. C-Sponge, I think, is no longer maintained. And you have this great game from Microsoft. You can download it for free. The Elevation of Privilege card game, which is a great way to actually create awareness with developers. There is a bunch of commercial tools. Microsoft, the Concept Draw. You've got smartboards if you don't want to write everything down on paper, because then you still have to digitize it. So this might actually be a more efficient way of doing so. Here are three tools that are currently having products in the threat model market. You've got Iris Risk, you've got Threat Modeler, and you've got SD Elements by Security Compass. And Tutoman has a threat model automation tool, but they're currently not in production yet. I think they're going to have a release candidate real soon. So if you want to learn about tools, we put in the links. If you want to learn more about threat modeling, there is the book by Adam Shostak, which describes in great detail everything that I have shown here and even more, because he also has attack trees and a whole bunch of other information in there. There is a book by Mr. Schoenfield that also talks about threat modeling, but it expands it a bit and it goes really on securing systems. The older book by Swiderski and Snyder on threat modeling is, I believe, from Microsoft Press. So it's when they were still actively outputting a lot of content on threat modeling. You have the PASTA book by Marco and Tony. So Marco is a professor and Tony works or has his own company in the US. So this book has a combination of both academia and real life practice in it. It's rather big. I think it's 700 pages long, if not longer. And it describes more or less an algorithm for you to follow. So if you are in an area where people are used to following strict processes, that is certainly a book you want to have a look at. Whereas the threat modeling book from Shostak and the methodology we showed is just answer the four questions however you see fit. It's a lot more open and pragmatic. If you want to learn about risk calculations, you can download the book on FAIR. And there is some online links in there. If you have questions on threat modeling, go to the OWASP Slack channel and there the threat model channel. There is about 850 people on there. And Adam Shostak and Brooke Schoenfield, Tony UV, they're all on there as well. So if you have a question, there you are almost sure that somebody is going to answer it. And if the answer is not of sufficient quality, then some of the others will certainly help correcting that or adding to the comments given. So this is a really great place to get lots and lots of information. And then the next trainings, well, this one has just passed, so sorry, you're too late for that one. But if you want to come to any of the others, you are quite welcome to come. We also have a Threat Model Insider newsletter that you can subscribe to using that QR code. And if you need, if you have questions on the exercises or the slide deck, you can send me an email or just contact me on the Slack channel. So that's it. I'm running 10 minutes over. I don't know how long it is before the next session starts here. Ah, okay. So then we have time for questions because we're not inside somebody else's time anyway. So I'll be here for another couple of hours walking around if you have more questions.
Thank you.
Thank you.